The education sector in the country has been one of the sectors that has been heavily affected by the COVID-19 pandemic here in the country. We got to an extent of having 5 million Ugandans, we're talking about the students, leave school and get back to their parents' home, all in the name of avoiding mass gatherings like we understand schools get to be. But a couple of measures have been put in place by the Ministry of Education and Sports to make sure that education does get to go on within the country. We have seen TV stations as well as radio stations coming together to make sure that they do have information or lessons that are conducted on these particular platforms in order for the students at home to be able to catch up with the syllabus and also not be as idle as anyone would think of them to come out to be. But this has also raised a couple of concerns as far as, you know, some students are concerned. Some educationists seem out to say that this is not an effective way, because we understand even in a classroom we have students who definitely pick up on different ages compared to others, and this is why a couple of conversations have come through. Do despise, of course, this happening on different platforms as far as education is concerned. Willis Daly, what is your take on, you know, having these classes conducted on radio and TV in a particular place?
What I know is that radio and TV has exposed a number of teachers. We now know some schools that are not teaching, but wasting our money and the time of our children. But there's like a video I saw of a teacher. Gabia nyonyola mu chemistry bifunyo. Bifunze nga yasoma kwa chemistry nga ndaba alimbi abana. I think these are some of the advantages of COVID-19. Some teachers are going to be exposed as before, and ultimately some schools are going to be exposed as wrong. But moving on to, you know, the way education sector is evolving with COVID-19, that now we have to think about other ways of teaching our children. But we also need to ask ourselves that in this 2020, which is the information age, Google, you know, information all over the place, the internet, do we really still need some of these subjects taught in class? You understand? If you look at the numbers of people in Uganda on the internet right now, can't they afford to have their children on the internet so that a child can be able to do research and learn on the internet? Doesn't this mean that the Minister of Education needs to sit down very fast and revise some of these you know, subjects vis-a-vis the curriculum? You know, doesn't it mean that now we have to think about other ways and other professions and let kids do what they love? You understand? As opposed to having them do something in the curriculum, according to the curriculum. So that are some of the questions that COVID-19 has brought into play, that now we have to sit and seriously think about education. Because if you're saying, for example, in physics, Archimedes' principle, you have a senior two student at home and the teacher is on TV teaching them Archimedes' principle. Should we take that as the gospel truth as parents? Or should we sit down and say, but my child can learn more about Archimedes' principle on the internet? You understand? So that's where the conversation is going. This coaching business, this teaching, and you know, I've seen people saying that there are teachers who are getting students to pass in the back doors of schools and teach them in the back doors of some premises and teach them. Those are, you know, those are lawbreakers, because we've clearly put down measures and we're trying to fight COVID-19. But of course we know that there are some people who are going to be, who are going to try to act smart and try to be smart about it and, you know, bend the law. So as those, I think we should be, you know, dealing with according to the law. But we need to ask ourselves the most important question. Is the education sector the way it should be now in 2020? I think that should be the biggest question.
Talking about the big questions that we're having this particular morning on this conversation here, the government came out to say that they're going to be distributing radios to different, you know, sub-counties and counties to make sure that they bring these, you know, young chaps together so they can be able to do some learning on radios. Don't you think that this will be putting the lives of these children at stake? Because, I mean, we don't know where these children are coming from. We don't know where these students are coming from. Different backgrounds, different home states. We don't know what they meet on their way to come to that particular place where there is that radio. Don't you think that at the end of the day we are affecting, you know, the people, the future for tomorrow as far as the nation is concerned?
Well, I think that, you know, the other day I was in my car coming from home and I think I was listening to CBS and they had a math teacher laboring to explain perpendicular lines.
Mm.
You see perpendicular, I draw the line from up to down, and I'm just, I can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
So if me, an adult, can fail to understand what the teacher is explaining on radio, then what about a 14-year-old? You understand? You're telling them to listen to classes on radio.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's too desperate. It's too desperate. On TV, yes, someone might be seeing what's going on. But how about the student-teacher interaction?
Mm.
How is that going to be? When a student does not understand something, where do they go for help? You understand?
Mm.
So I think that we can afford to lose a year.
Can we?
Yeah. We can, because we've already lost it.
Some schools are already asking for, you know, extra money from the parents.
The government...
I've seen
Kampala parents.
Yes.
I see my Chagara Bogerako. The one I was Sudino Limusawaye. I've seen the Kampala parents later asking for 1.8 million for online courses. But you see, we live in a free market. In Uganda is a free market.
Mm.
It's not a communist kind of economy.
Mm.
It's a capitalist economy. It's a free market where you can come, put your service, price it, and people pay it. If they don't want, they go.
Mm.
That's how it is. So if Kampala parents is asking for 1.8 million shillings, you take your child to Chitante where they'll ask for 50K for online courses.
Mm.
You understand?
Mm.
So let's not blame Kampala parents on this one. But I'm saying that if you think about the number of students we have across Uganda, you said 5 million and over. And you think about the teacher-to-student ratio.
Mm.
And you think about the media of, teaching, how these teachers are going to get the information to the students.
Mm.
How then are you going to grade these children? Because we receive TV signals differently.
Mm-hmm.
We receive radio signals differently. When children are at home, the timetable has changed. They are not all uniform.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
Mm.
So how are you going to examine these students and find out if they've understood or not?
Mm.
So that's where, you know, I come to say that for me, my idea would be, let's lose the year. Let's have these children learn other aspects of life. This is the chance for a child to learn how to hunt, for a child to learn how to make a ball, for a child to learn how to dig. Most of these kids don't know how to do these things.
Mm.
Why? Because they spend 4 months in school and 2 weeks at home. But thanks to COVID-19, now you can spend months with your child.
Mm-hmm.
The question should be, as a parent, what has your child learned at home?
During the stay down.
Most parents are now scared. Hey, mwana wange tasoma, ayibana ye. Umatake nafuka musiru, muyigirize bintu ebirala. You're in Kampala, but as you go to work, tell your child to make pancakes and take them to the road and sell.
Okay.
They are learning a skill. I think that is where the Minister of Education should go. That let's have programs on TVs and radio to help these children adopt other skills in life, because the world has changed. I can learn a physics lesson off the internet. I can do the research and give it to my kids and they'll learn. But what I cannot be able to do as a child is to learn a practical skill of the internet, of television. So what I think is for the education sector, for the people in education, to think about ways in which they can put these skills on television and radio. I would be very comfortable to tell my 14-year-old to sit down and listen to someone teach about digging a toilet on radio. Rather than telling them about Simanya, a floating object floats underwater unless
it's hypotenuse theories.
You understand? So I'm thinking that's where the direction should be.
Honorable Eli Tumwine came out to address this particular concern at a press media conference that did take place this particular week, and this is what he had to say.
Tandike mu Luganda ndali naye kuyogera mu Luzungu. Twafunye amawulire nti abasomesa abamu batandise coaching. Baita abaana mu maka gaabwe ne beekuŋŋaaniramu bangi. Mukireke abaana basomere ku radio oba televisioni oba mu papula bye babasindikira aba Minister of Education. Coaching mu maka gamwe abasomesa tekikirizibwa.
Coaching is one of the things that we cannot let slip out when we're having this conversation, because we understand, you know, some parents have, you know, the ability to have teachers come to their homes and, you know, do some, you know, private teaching and coaching in their homesteads. But do you think this should also be stopped, like the minister is saying? Do you agree with him?
I think the coaching he should be talking about is when a teacher is hiring a premise, you know, and is having kids come over to learn, 20, 30 kids coming over to learn. But me coming to your home and teaching your son, They can't trace that.
I don't know where you're coming from. I don't know which people you have met on the way.
They can't trace that. The moment they opened up public transport and private transport, you can't trace it as government. You can't know if I've left my home to go to Derek's home to teach his child. You understand? So I think that the law should deal with those that are congregating children from different areas and they are teaching them and they are coaching them and they are making some little bit of money. But I also think that we need to educate our teachers and say, look, the world has changed right now. Either we wole, ofuneyo kaloni, ofune computer, or ofune ka camera katono tono, or recording lessons, because now people are going to buy lessons. I'm going to be at my place and say, who's the best physics teacher? Do they have recorded lessons of a physics topic? You understand? That's where we are going. So as a teacher, obviously,
to just take you off the point just for a minute, so just to let you know that I have a recorded clip of myself talking about a particular chapter in biology. Reproduction. So in case, there's someone out there who needs to learn more
reproduction,
about
reproduction. In which way?
Biology. Biology. We're talking about biology. We're looking at all level of biology. Then science in primary level just name.
Reproduction.
Reproduction. Your topic here. Ilaka kilipu nkaina. Aka chapter yona.
Obadina. Our opponent student inga akose ewe ziza njajigula. Uwe topic enyuma.
Topic enyuma. Osegera. Now, Willis, njaga la tupe yao tuogele ku another area of concern in the city. Traffic jam. Every time it clocks, to 3 p.m. Traffic jam within Kampala just becomes another thing to talk about every particular single day. Actually, someone is saying 1 p.m. Whenever it clocks to 1 p.m., it is traffic all over the place. We are having, private cars moving. You're having public means of transport also operating. But at the end of the day, people need to stick to their work. But the biggest query here is that they always get into the curfew time. Now, I don't know, what would be the best advice you'd give to an average Ugandan to, live within their means of, respecting curfew at the end of the day, but being able to also put themselves as far as, getting something to put in their pocket is concerned?
Well, you cannot beat traffic jam in Kampala. It doesn't matter what kind of urban planning you are. The Ngavidanos of this world thinking about the bicycle thing, which is a good thing. But I think you can't beat, there will always be some traffic in the prime time. Why? Because of the works, schedules that we have in Uganda and the working hours that the Minister of Public Service and the government have been able to put in place, that it's from, 8 a.m. To 5 p.m. That is why we have traffic in Kampala. I've seen the likes of Andrew Mwenda and other people, other dissenting voices talking about release borders.
Border borders, yes.
Go. Of course, before the taxes were put into play, people were saying, if you release the taxi,
it's going to be worse.
Traffic jam will be over. You said, is it over?
It's not yet.
No. Traffic jam is not caused by the lack of borders or taxis or the numbers of private cars we have. No. Traffic jam is caused by the working hours that we have in Kampala. Traffic jam was more when the bars were less. When bars increased, we have now people working at night, when you have the likes of the Ubers and taxifiers coming on board, and people, no longer have to wait for 5 p.m. for prime time. You understand? So the traffic jam sort of reduced. If you remember, like 3 years ago, traffic jam in Kampala was a mess. You would sit and spend about 20K in your fuel tank. You understand? But now it has sort of reduced. The factors are not because the number of cars have reduced off the road or public transport has increased. It's because people have now revised their working hours. You understand? And now people can be able to work by themselves. So the moment we solve the question of working hours, that someone can be able to work online, that someone can be able to work at home, traffic jam will be a problem solved.
Honorable Eli Tumwine, the same person, came out to address this particular issue of traffic congestion, and he said that they are going to be writing to different organizations, to different institutions, to make sure that some people do get to stay and work from home in order to reduce on the traffic congestion on the roads. Is this visible? Is this viable? Is it something that can actually happen?
Yes, it is. Because some organizations,
given our limitation in internet coverage within the country, we have to also put that into consideration. Because if you're expecting someone to work from home, that means they'll need internet. They'll literally need fast internet.
Give you an example, and I don't want to sound racist, but if you've worked for Indians, you will know that an Indian wants to see you doing something. Like It's not about telling them that you've delivered. They want to see you doing something. If you're a cleaner, you're supposed to be pushing your car thing around. At no matter cleaning, and then you're pushing, and you're satisfied. So that mentality is what I think, you know, the general is talking about. That let's have people deliver work. Let's focus on the work. If someone in the ministry can be home, send emails, and write proposals, let them stay at home. I think I agree with him on that one. That way, one car is less off the road. And we have most of these people who leave home, drive to the city in the prime time, you know, when traffic is heavy, and they leave their coats in the offices and go and do other things. So all those people, to say that, you know, Minister of Public Service needs to write down to different ministries and say, I think this person can work from home. Let's get them internet, a laptop, and let them work from home. I think it's a good thing. Plus also, you realize that the new cities are also going to help us cap down on the city, on the traffic jam in Kampala. Most of these guys are going to start going out.
What kind of work output put different institutions and organizations into an extra cost? Because we understand most of these are working institutions. They are laying off workers. You know, they're asking workers to go and leave without pay because the business is not bringing in money, which you cannot blame them, definitely. Now, you are asking them to, you know, lay off some people to actually work from home, meaning that means they will have to provide for infrastructure needed in order for this person to deliver their work from home. Isn't it an extra cost?
As Ugandans and Africans, we have always worked from home. Our grandfathers would wake up in the morning, get a hoe, and go to the garden, which is home. And they work the whole day at home and get back
Times
to the house.
Times have changed, Willis. It's no longer that
Think about that. I think what you're talking about is discipline. That can people work from home and deliver? I think yes.
I think they can.
Yes.
But my worry here is the infrastructure. What does people need in order for them to, you know, work and deliver?
You're like the opposition. Now that government has said, or the Electoral Commission has said, that we shall have a digital campaign, they're asking for data. You have had data to abuse people online.
Yes.
How can you not have data to watch a campaign?
I'm talking about data that is going to help me yield my job, not personal.
You are a guy who has had data at home and been on social media for all this time. You clearly can't spare 200 MBs to send an email. You've had airtime to cheat on your wife, and you don't have airtime to call your boss.
It's more than an email, Willis. It's more than an email.
What is it? What does it take, for example, for an HR to work from home? What does it take? Like, if you look at it clearly, why can't an HR work from home?
So are you saying that the HR's work is basically to send emails?
What? Tongo bia wano. But an HR can work from home. What is wrong with a procurement officer working from home? What do they need in office? Okujako kunyocha no kube mbozi. Can't these guys work from home? They can. I think that those that need to work in offices are those that have manual jobs. If your job is to move a thing, I think you need it. And I'm not saying that if you're working from home, you're not essential, you're not important. The organization needs you, but now we need to split the organization so that the organization works in different places. I think that's great. If you can have some departments work from home, I think it will work. It will reduce traffic, it will increase productivity, because someone will not be able to be influenced by another. So you'll be in your own space, deliver work. I think it's okay.
Okay.
I think it's good. All right. Laying off of workers. If the axe hasn't come to your company, it is coming.
Anytime.
People are going to lose jobs.
That is the new normal.
It is there. It is the new normal. The question is, have you been able to develop a skill that you can be able to use to make a living? That should be the question right now. If you haven't, you need to now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Talking about making a living, I want us to talk about another interesting group of people. You know, we're looking at hairdressers, we're looking at barbers that are, you know, working in saloons. Saloons are one of those places that have remained closed as we speak right about now. They're not allowed to operate because apparently they cannot be able to deal with the mass gatherings or the crowds of people that usually are in these places. At the end of the day, the Association of Saloon and Spas has come out, you know, through their personnel individual to, you know, talk to the government and ask them to let them operate, to let them, you know, get back into business, that they will be following the different SOPs. Rumor has it that apparently there are some people who are taken into the saloon from the back door, walked on and then left, you know, they let them go back home, which we are not so sure about. I don't know if you've seen it happen.
It's not a rumor.
Is it happening?
It's not a rumor.
Have you sneaked behind the salon?
No, me, I haven't. But I know someone who has. I know someone who has, you know, sneaked behind the entered.
Never dewaka.
It's not a rumor.
Would you agree with, you know, these people that they should, you know, be put back to work? Do you feel like, you know, their essential, you know, work is actually needed that much?
I think for every business that makes money, it means it's essential.
Okay.
That somewhere, somehow, people need it. That is why it's making money. And that should be the basis for determining who is essential and who is not. I think that a saloon is not only an essential aspect of life, but also important, because a saloon, for me, in my own opinion, can help fight COVID-19.
How?
Because a saloon is sanitized 24/7. Okay, barbershop. A saloon is sanitized 24/7. These guys have spirit everywhere, all the time. Their sprays, you know, they work on the head, and just after you leave the saloon, even if a virus just comes in, it can die. You understand?
Really?
So I think, no, I'm not saying that it's a joke. But I'm saying that a saloon is sanitized. A saloon just needs a little bit of twitch, just discipline for it to be able to, you know, stand the times of COVID-19. So I don't see a reason why these guys cannot think about a saloon as important. Probably because for them, they have machines in their houses.
It's because they don't feel like it will be able to attain the huge numbers. I mean, you're looking at a small vicinity like this one that has more than about, you know, 9 people in it. We're talking about the hairdressers, we're talking about the people that are going to cut the nails, we're talking about, you know, the barbers themselves, we're talking about the cashier. Already you have like 9 people in the same small setting. Now you have excluded the customers. Now if you have the customers included, you have about 15 people and a plus, which is very hard to attain. I mean, we are looking at groups of people not being more than 5. That's why we are having scientific marriages, scientific funerals.
Most of the fluids in a saloon can act as sanitizers. So I think it's just incumbent upon government to give guidelines of saloons. That would be an easy one. The hardest one would be a taxi. But if you can let taxis move, you know, taxis that get, you know, 6 people, 7 people in a taxi at a time. If you're letting private cars move, if you're letting some markets work, you're saying malls should work. I think saloons can be able to work. And I think saloons are the most disciplined people, because I've seen very few. The people who are passing, you know, people behind are very few. They are very few. Most of the saloons are actually closed. Apart from the ones who are doing door-to-door work, the barbers, they are doing door-to-door work. And I think that's where these owners also need to think and say, okay, COVID-19 has come, but how does it change the business? That now, as a saloon, you need to be able to do homework, like home deliveries. You go and deliver a haircut. You understand? Then me, I thought a saloon was not essential until this hair started growing. And then Bush told me, you're going to do the morning show in Onya Saloon. So I think that saloons are important and people need them. Otherwise, shall have
but saloon wa jije wa jo agenze.
Nagula machine. Nagula
machine.
Ojina.
Oli sure.
Ndina na ene sarebi goli bwebuzimu. But I think saloons are important.
All right, now talking about the importance of saloon, we have a clipper that is going to be disseminating most of this information to you.
Na ye kenjo kede ni saloons are important. Umanya wakaza hageno kumkwa na wana.
Let's check out this clip. We'll be right back.
Tusaba government. Etuyambe. Etukirize. Saloon zafe. Zigureo. Etuwa mateka emitendera. Jetuno kuitamu. Okurabanti. Tukora kuba customers wafe. Mungeri. Eziza. Echirwade. Cha COVID okusasana. Ensonga za fenkuru ziri za tusaba kugulibwao atera tusaba government okukwatira ko ku bakozi baffe ne bananyinyi saruni okubawo kubanga edakiika eno embeera mbi abaana tebana kyakulya embeera mbi era ensonga lwaki abamu batandise okwebirira ne bagenda ne bakola ku bantu mu nkukutu.
Amanya agange. Nze Nakasiga Christine, na nze mwogezi wa Association of Saloons and Spas in Uganda, ASU. Era tusaba, government etuwulirize bulungi, kubanga tuli beetegefu okukolera wansi wa mateeka gaayo, nga tusaba bakkirize nti emirimu gye tukola giri wansi w'amateeka ag'obusawo ate tugigoberera. Tugoberera amateeka gano kubanga tukwata ku byabulamu.